Well, praise the Lord. Good to have everybody here on the first day of January of 2023. You know, it's not too often that we get to have Sunday service on the very first day of the year. And those that's watching, be praying for you, because it's nothing like being in the presence of the Lord as soon as you get.
Lord, be my defense. took a shepherd boy and made him a king. So I'll trust you and give you everything. I'll be a conqueror, cause you fight for me. I'll be a champion, claim your victory. I see him fall.
Stand as to as when you come, Jesus.
Stand as to
when you come, Jesus.
See me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me heart.
With confidence. Well, good morning. Good to see everybody this first day of 2023. How many stayed up last night till 12 o'clock? How many got rested and said, I'm going to bed and just rest like I usually do? Well, she went to bed like she used to do, and for some reason, I ended up going to bed right at midnight, so it wasn't planned that way, and I wasn't in no celebrating the new year coming in, but I was up and did give me a lot of things to pray about as I was trying to go to sleep, which that's the way I used to do, is pray till I go to sleep. And I guess that's why it don't take long for me to go to sleep, because the devil don't want us to pray. All right, got your Bible this morning. Let's do our confession of faith. You hold your Bible up. You say it like you mean it. You mean it like you say it, because it is God's personal love letter to you. This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
I am what it says I am.
I am what it says I am.
I have what it says I have.
I have what it says I have.
And I can do what it says I can do.
Do what it says I can do.
Today I'll be taught.
Today I'll be taught.
The Word of God.
The Word of God.
I boldly confess.
I boldly confess.
My mind is alert.
My mind is alert.
And my heart's receptive.
My heart's receptive.
I'm about to receive.
I'm about to receive.
The incorruptible.
The incorruptible.
Indestructible,
indestructible,
ever living seed of the Word of God.
Word of God.
I'll never be saved.
Never,
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 never, never.
I'll never be saved.
Never be
in
saved.
Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Hallelujah. I want you to be turning in your Bible to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Oh, mate, how many could tell the difference this morning when you got up and it's January 1st, 2023? Tell any difference? Probably not. And, you know, it's like I said, probably those that went to bed got up feeling just as good as they ever did. And once it stayed up late, say, boy, I wish I'd went to bed. It's not worth staying up to after midnight, because it's a new day. But do you realize that every day is a new day? And, you know, I think that's what happens, is that we take the first day as stepping into a new year, and usually the 1st of January, then you have people, companies, all getting their mindset into businesses, into tax time, and all that other things. You're CPAs are trying to get up, make certain that they have all the latest updates so that they can do the best for you that they can do. And with that said, typically people, a lot of people, make New Year's resolutions. Anybody in here made any New Year's resolution? I didn't. Because usually if you make them, you break them, and it's usually in a very short period of time. But as a Christian, things should be different. We should be wanting more of a relationship with God, more obedient to the Lord, and letting God use us more than ever. And that's why we should have an expectancy. Not just when we come to church on Sunday mornings, or we listen to a Bible study, or minister, or read a book. It's a time that we need to have our expectancy level higher than ever before. And I will say that, you know, a lot of times on December 31st, that going into 2000 or into January 1st, that you'll reminisce about the things throughout the years that took place. And how many knows that there's a lot of things that sometimes that some people would say, boy, I wish I could just forget that. And then there's things that may happen in your life that you're thinking, man, you know, that was a good moment in my life. And for some, it's a time that they start out fresh. Hey, everybody can change. Anybody can at any time. You don't have to wait till the first of the year or whatever. Now, if you with me in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, let's look at verse 17. Therefore, now always pay attention. When you see the word therefore, there's a reason for it being there. So, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are what? Passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Hallelujah. Father God, we just come to you this beautiful January 1st to worship and honor you and thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us throughout this past year. Lord, we have no idea what you have in store for us this next year. But I pray that, Lord, our hearts be open to you, our minds be receptive, and that, Lord God, you just use each and every one of us in a great and dramatic way, that we give you honor and glory in every step that we make. And so, Lord, we just ask that you have your way here with your people this morning, and that, Lord, the Holy Spirit just minister to each and every one of us. And we just thank you and we praise you, Lord, for your word that is everlasting, that's ever settled in heaven. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, as a Christian, we should live like we're that new creature. We should live as Christ would have us to live. And, you know, all things become new. In other words, how many knows that sometimes that in life we have problems in our life? Sometimes there's grudges, sometimes there's hurt, sometimes it's our feelings get messed up, sometimes there's disappointments, and everything that can will try to keep you from moving forward with God. But as Paul was writing to the Corinthians, same as he is writing to us, if any man or person be in Christ, he is a new creature. Now, how many times have you ever looked at somebody and said, well, I just don't think they're ever going to change? They're still the same old, doing the same old, same old. You know what? All it takes is one meeting with the Lord Jesus Christ. And in that one meeting with the Lord Jesus Christ, if they truly give their heart to the Lord Jesus Christ, they'll become a new creature with a new feature and a new future. And that is through by knowing the Lord Jesus. And by doing that, all old things are passed away. That quite often I'll be talking to somebody, and if it's one of my former classmates back in school, you take that's been a long time ago, and that we'll talk a little bit, and they say, "You remember this?" Well, I said, "Not really." I said, "I just let the old go." I said, "I try ever sit for." I said, "For 32 years, I lived for the devil, and for the past 32 years, I'm living for the Lord Jesus Christ." And so that's passed away. The dumb things that I used to do, I don't do. I don't think about. I don't want to think about them, because I'm moving forward to the Lord Jesus. God's got better plans than what we think of, because if we'd ever understand how far God wants to take us, it would be better than we can imagine. If you go to Galatians chapter 2, in verse 20, Paul writes, "I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." Paul's telling, he said, "You know what, I live. You see me, flesh and blood. And in my flesh and blood, I'm not perfect. But you know what, I don't live for me. I live for Jesus. I live for Christ. Because he loved me so much." And if we could grasp that, when we get up in the morning, we should get in the presence of God immediately. "Lord, what you got planned today?" Because it's a brand new day. Because how many of y'all have ever lived January 1st or January 2nd, 2023? None of us have lived January 1st, 2023. We've made it till here it is after 11 o'clock. We've made it that far. We know what has happened. But do we know what's going to happen at 4 o'clock, at 5 o'clock, or at 9 o'clock tonight? No, we have no idea. You know, as a Christian, we should be living for Jesus, because he's the one that knows what we're going to go on. You know, it's sort of like the Christmas messages when ministers preach about the wise men, and they traveled hundreds and hundreds of miles to see the God King, the baby child Jesus, the Messiah. And today's generation, they want God to come to them instead of them going to God. It's just a reverse. I mean, today people think, "Well, God, I snap my fingers, you better move." It don't happen like that. We're to find God in our life every day, the things that Jesus would have us to do. Philippians chapter 3, verse 13 through 14. Paul writes, "Brethren," who's he writing to? Us. "I count not myself to have apprehended. But this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." Oh my. He said, "You know what? I've not got it yet. I've not quite apprehended." And you might as well say, he hadn't quite comprehended. Because I know that I haven't quite comprehended what God's got in store for me. And I doubt if you have got that in your mindset, that you know what God's got in store for you. And every day that we live, we're to try and to reach for the things of God. Try to press. See, there isn't anything in your past
that can be changed. You can't change what you did at 8 o'clock this morning, much less what happened 10 years ago, or 20 years ago, or 40 years ago, or 60 years ago. You can't change none of that. So why let yourself be consumed and worried and have anxiety about your past? Why not focus on today? You know, there's nothing wrong making plans for the future. But yet, till you get to that future, you're still living today. It's like young people. As young kids, they think of all the things they may want to do. Lord knows that I don't know what I would have done if I had did the things that I dreamed of doing when I was a kid. I mean, I had things planned from being a dentist to being a forest ranger to being a race car driver to being a diesel mechanic and all of that. And didn't do none of that other than drive trucks and et cetera on that. Because sometimes we get caught up, but then as your life goes on and years pass by, did you accomplish the goals that you thought about? You know, it's easy at the end of the year to get caught up on reflecting about yesterday. Go to Matthew chapter 6. Because Jesus, if your Bible's red letter, you'll know that Jesus said this. And in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33 and 34, he said, "But seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." Now, you go back and read all that. It tells about clothes and everything that you have need of. He knows that. And then in verse 34, "Take there no thought for tomorrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof." In other words, do we spend our time looking at something way, way, way down the road? Or are we looking at right now as, God, what can we do? You know, if you're at work, are you aware of the presence of God with you? Are you saying, Lord, help me to do a good job? Or you just say, well, here we are, another day, another dollar. Well, that used to be the old saying. I guess the new saying is another day and another 10 cents. But you know, we live this. And if what we do every day that affects our tomorrow, and until we get through today, we don't know what tomorrow holds. I wonder how many that were, like I was one time, a partier, got arrested last night, headed home, and is waking up in jail this morning. And they're thinking, what in the world have I went and done? Have you ever had one of those moments that you just thought, what am I doing? This is the most ridiculous. This is crazy. It's like the devil wants us to be a glutton for punishment. But God wants us to be that new creature with a new feature and a new future. And if we put on Christ every day, we have to die to our flesh. You know, there's some times that I just don't I can have an attitude. Any y'all ever have that moment that you feel like you have an attitude? That you just sometimes would just like to reach out and pinch somebody's little head off because you just having a bad day or having an attitude and they just making it worse. Well, probably every one of us has, as far as that, if we're honest with ourselves. And we have to think about life. You know, there's nothing, like I said before, there's nothing wrong with devoting time to think out what we're going to do. You know, you just don't, well, I'm going to go buy a house. Well, you got to take in consideration of what it's going to cost and all that. Nothing wrong with that. Plan for the future, there's nothing wrong with. But we live in the present. And that's why we have to be, think about everything. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6 says, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Why is people, or Paul trying to get everyone to do, is to quit worrying and quit having anxiety?
And what'd you say, Philippians 4 what?
Verse 6. You see, when we learn to cast all of our cares on God, when we learn to not be worrying about everything, when we learn not to have anxiety, we learn to give it to the Lord. We learn to pray unto God. And when we learn to do that, then look what verse 7 says. The peace of God and the peace of God, which passeth all understandings, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. In other words, you have to be Christ-minded. You have to be Christ-focused. You have to look at God. You have to look for it. One thing that the new year does do is to make us think about our future. The plans that we have, at least for the next 365 days. I'll never forget, we just turned to the Lord back in 1990. And then in December of 1999, some of y'all probably still may have not even been born or was just kids in school. But it was the year that we was going into 2000, known as Y2K. And people say, well, the computer system's going to shut down and this is going to happen. And everybody needs to stockpile. And I kept thinking, and one of my mentor, Mr. Kobe, he was into prophecy. And he said, Randy, you ought to be ready. You have at least a 3-6 month supply of food. And I said, well, Jim, what do you think's going to happen if everything shuts down and everybody else is starving, and they look at Jim and see, Jim's still eating high on the hog. I said, they're going to come pay a visit to you. He said, I have never thought about that. I said, Jim, I don't think there's anything going to happen because there's too much hype about it. And the Bible says that no, not one knows the day or hour when the Lord shall come back. Jesus said, I don't even know. It's up to the Father. When the Father says, go, Son, I'm coming after you. That's why we need to be ready 24-7. It doesn't matter whether it's January 1st or December 31st or any day in between. Being ready for the Lord is the main thing. Let me give you another verse of Scripture to think about. We always need to make certain that God's involved in everything that we do. And we may not understand his plans, but if God is directing us, it will work out. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 6, it says, "In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths." In all thy ways. In all thy ways. In other words, everything you do, are you aware of the presence of God? I remember I was doing youth service at our home church. And one Wednesday night, we were had the kids in our, where we had our service. And I said, "Now y'all know that God knows what you think." And everybody looked, all the kids, girls, boys. And I said, "God knows when those, when you girls look at them boys and think, boy, that is one hunk of a young man." And I heard one of the girls say, "Oh, no." And I'm thinking, and I said, so I said, "Well, God knows when you guys look at one of them girls and say, she is one pretty girl." And they looked at each other. I said, "If you're born again, God is with you 24/7. You're never by yourself because God is with you. And if you acknowledge him," that's what's so precious about going into this new year. If we apply Proverbs chapter 3, verse 6, "If in all thy ways acknowledge him," in other words, "Lord, good morning. How are you doing, Lord? How are you doing, Holy Spirit?" Holy Spirit's in us. We got him, we got God the Father, we got God the Son. And we on a journey today. When's the last time you got up with that attitude? And when, what do you usually get up to? "Well, today's Monday, let's see this, gotta do this, gotta do this, gotta do that." And you get focused on everything that's work related. And you forget that Jesus is the main part of your life. You're alive in Christ. And that's why we have to learn. We have to learn. Paul said, "I have learned." Why? Because it don't just come like that. It don't just happen like that. You have to do your part. And if you'll do your part, God, and the word says, he shall direct thy path. In other words, God will point you in the right direction to do the right things the right way. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. "For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace, not evil, to give you an expected end." In other words, plans to prosper and not hurt you. Plans to give you hope and a future. That's the type of God that we serve. He loves us. And yet, we fail to understand that if God isn't in our priority, if we was to make a priority list, what would you put? Now, I know. Now, don't get me wrong, because I know how people think in our surrounding Galax, Grayson, Carroll, Surrey, and Allegheny counties. Because sometimes they know what you want to hear. They'll tell you what you want to hear. You know that they lying to you. They know that you're lying to them. But they just go ahead and tell you whatever they think that you want to hear, just so that you'll be satisfied. And the matter of fact is that God wants us to put him first. That's why if we had, where's God on your priority list? And everybody says, "Well, God's first." Is he? Or is it family, work, church, God? How is it? See, we have to learn how to make certain that we do things God's way. You know, how many of y'all ever run slack on patience?
I'll do.
I mean, you want it over and done with, or you wanted it yesterday, and you're just trying to get it. You see, sometimes our lack of patience is our failing to listen to God because we got a long-distance relationship. How many knows what a long-distance relationship is? It's like a husband and wife, they get married. And the husband says, well, honey, I'm going to work now. I'll see you next year on our anniversary. And he goes. Of course, it could be the spouse saying, well, dear husband, I love you so much, and I'll see you on our anniversary. You know, sometimes we do that with God. We just put him to the side, not recognizing that he is with us. He wants the best for us. Does that mean that we'll never have no problem? Absolutely not, because we will have problems. If you serve in the Lord, you become number one on the enemy's hit list. The devil don't like nobody that serves the Lord Jesus. And that's why sometimes it makes life a little bit rough. One last verse of scripture I want to give you. Joshua chapter 1, verse 9. Says, have I not commanded thee? Be strong. Good courage. Be not afraid. Neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. That's what God told Joshua back 2,000 years before Christ. And guess what? Well, 1,400 years before Christ. And guess what? 2,000 years ago, Jesus said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you, but I'll be with you until the ends of the world or the end of time. And then we got a choice. We'll either spend eternity with the Lord Jesus in a new heaven and a new earth, or you'll spend eternity in the lake of fire, where the fire is never quenched, where the worm dieth not. You know, I struggle with my flesh just like everybody else does, because it don't like waiting. It doesn't like patience. Yet when I keep my body in submission to the Lord, everything goes so much smoother. I know when I was a babe in Christ, oh, I had my moments. And God put me through. I mean, he let me go through things I wouldn't want nobody to go through. And yet it helped to educate me. Because sometimes I don't know why God lets things happen the way he does. Why does sometimes you're going, how many's ever had a flat going to work? Ever run out of gas going to work? I have. And you think, why? Why does something like it happen? There is no accidents with God. Everything is by design. There is no such thing as luck. No. It's either our choice or it's by God's design. Sometimes God lets us do what we want to do. He doesn't make us do anything. That's why back in Matthew chapter 6, when he said, but seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. In other words, quit thinking about what's going to happen to tomorrow. Are you focused on today? Huh. You know, I watched some of the football yesterday. I like college football, and It's not been a good season for the team that I like the best, but that was expected. And it was like last night. I had been back in the office and getting ready, and I thought, well, okay, Lord, so we're ready for tomorrow. And I thought, well, I turned the TV down real low because she went to bed, and I thought, I'm going to last the last little bit of this game. And I was hoping this one team would win. And in the last less than minute to go, they lost. They lost. With 8 seconds to go, they could have won the game. But their field goal kicker, he kicked a knuckleball. It didn't go up in the air. It went way wide left. And before they were 11, 14 points ahead. And the amazing thing was, and I found a lot of humor in it, was that watching the fans of each side, and when their side was, one side was making a comeback, whoo, yeah, they were hollering and shouting, smiles on their face. But when the other team kept scoring also, and it looked like it was going to be bad, they would just frown up. You know, sort of like Christians sometimes. Have you ever seen a Christian that looked like they had been sucking lemons and eating prunes? They didn't have no smile on their face. When the truth is, we should be the happiest people on planet Earth. Why? Because we're on God's side. God's on our side. And He's directing our steps so that we come out of life victorious. We have to do our part. Jesus done that. He said it's done. It's finished. And then along comes the apostles. They went from being disciples to becoming apostles. And Paul, you know, when he said, I forget those things that are behind and reach for those things that are ahead. Can you imagine what Paul had to forget? He had to forget that after Jesus ascended up into heaven, he held the coats for the ones that stoned Stephen to death, who became the first martyr of the Lord Jesus Christ in the book of Acts. He held the coats of the men that murdered the first Christian minister that preached. Not only that, he had to forget about going from city to city, town to town, finding Christians that believe in Jesus Christ and having them arrested. And some of them were probably as well killed because they professed to be Christians. Till he was on the road to Damascus, and he himself had one encounter with Jesus Christ. One encounter that changed Paul's life forever. That one encounter, Paul said, Lord, what will thou have me to do? And from that one encounter, Paul never quit on serving Jesus Christ. Even in Paul's writings, he says, they didn't accept me because they knew that what I used to do. How many knows that sometimes people look at you from your past and say, mm-mm, I keep my eye on that person. I just don't trust them. And Paul said, that's all right. That's why I let go of yesterday, and I'm reaching for tomorrow. I'm pressing on. I'm going to get close to God. I've not quite apprehended everything God's got for me, but I'm going to get there. I'm going to get it. And there at the end, Paul says, I've fought the good fight of faith. I've kept my course. And there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness when I get to heaven. Why? Because Paul knew that he had something in him. That's why to live is Christ. To die is gain. He knew that something changed his life. And from that point on, every day was an adventure with Paul. We have no idea what it would have been to have been Paul if it wasn't for him writing to Timothy. We wouldn't know about him being put in a lion's den and God protect him from the lions like he did Daniel. He'd been on, I think, two or three shipwrecks. We know about the one where he ended up on the Isle of Melita. We knew about him being stoned and cast out of the city because they thought he was dead. Life come back in his body and he was ready to go back in. They say, Paul, they didn't try to kill you one time. You going to let them do it again? Paul said, I'm going to be about the Father's business. I'm going to be focused on what God wants me to do. Paul said, you know, it doesn't matter what happens. When I'm weak, my Jesus is strong. And Paul was just like us when he started out. Because whenever he said that in Corinthians, he was saying, you know, there was a messenger of Satan that had been sent to buffet me. I sought the Lord three times to remove that thorn in the flesh that had been just making my life miserable. How many of y'all ever had people just trying to make your life miserable? And he said, I don't know in spirit, out of spirit, but God took me up. And he said, Paul, my grace is sufficient.
What verse was that?
It's in Corinthians. And when Paul grasped the meaning, that's when he grasped the meaning of grace. We all been given grace. It's a gift of God. God's presence, God's provision, God's power. He says, I will rather therefore gladly rejoice in my infirmities, in my weaknesses. Because when I am weak, my Jesus shows up. You got to let go to move forward. If you hang on to yesterday, you can't move into your tomorrow. If you're thinking about what went on yesterday, how are you going to think about what's going on? What does God want you to do today? That's why I let go of it. Let go of your yesterday. Let go of 2022. Let go of 2021. Let go of all of it. Remember the good things? Absolutely. The negative things, the bad things, all the things that mess you up, let go of them. Become that new creature with that new future. That all old things are passed away and all things become new. You may look the same, but inside, if you let go and let God, you'll be a changed person. You'll be a new creature. God starts on the inside and it shows up on the outside. Hallelujah. So, as always, those that are here, those that are watching, if you've never ever accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, there is no greater way than starting 2023 on a new note with the Lord Jesus in your life that will lead you, guide you, appoint your steps, watch over you, help you through difficult times. Take your sorrows, take your burdens, and do His will. But you have to be willing to believe in your heart, confess with your mouth unto salvation. So right now, let's just pray this simple prayer. And if you've never been saved, and if you backslid on God, it's as simple getting back in right standing with God as it was the day you got born again. All you have to do is confess. Repent, which means to turn. Instead of going the way you had been, turn to God. Go to the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's pray this prayer. Father God, I come to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Savior of all of humanity, the one who came and paid our sin debt, paid my sin debt. And Lord, I ask that my sins be forgiven. And according to your word, I believe that it has been and will never be remembered by you. I ask you, Lord, to fill me with your Holy Spirit, that from this day on, that I can live for you, that I can serve you, that our relationship will build into a strong, mighty force. So, Lord, I thank you and I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you prayed that prayer, expect God to work His will in your life. You have to be willing to let Him. You have to be willing to say, okay, Lord, what would you have me to do? You have to be willing to get in the Word and get into the house of the Lord to hear the Word. It'll make a world of difference. Remember Tuesday evening Bible study on Facebook at 6:30, and then later it'll be uploaded onto YouTube. And we hope and pray that everybody has a great first week of this new year. First day of the week till next Sunday, it'll be a new day. And remember, every day is a new day. So live it like you. So God bless you. Hope to see you later. Amen.